Now, I believe that God can save anybody, amen, that chooses to believe and come to accept Jesus Christ. Now, some people don't believe that Jesus can save them. You know what, church? The Bible says Jesus can save us to the uttermost. Amen. There's nothing that's so bad that God cannot save a sinner, those that come to him. The Bible says in John 3:16, that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. See, the Bible says God didn't send Jesus down to condemn the world, but through him the world could be saved. Amen. So Jesus come down to save every sinner that will come to him. God can save every one of them. The Bible tells us in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, beginning in verse 8. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 8 says, But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith. Church, we got to have faith. When we begin to pray, we got to believe that God will answer our prayer. When we come to having God to touch our lives, we got to have faith. He said, put on the breastplate of faith. Don't let nothing take your faith away from you. Then he goes on and says, and love, and for the helmet, the hope of salvation. For God hath not appointed us to wrath, but obtained salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ. So God wants everybody to be saved, and God can save anybody or anyone, those that choose to come to him. Aren't you glad tonight that you chose to come to Jesus? Aren't you glad tonight that God gave his own Son, that we could come to him and be saved? Amen. And church, let me tell you something. We were walking in darkness, like I preached this morning. The Bible said we were in the kingdom of darkness, and there was no light. And the devil was deceiving us and lead us in the wrong path, in a path of destruction. But thank God Jesus came, and we give our lives to him. And I'll tell you, church, when I got saved, I was never the same, because, church, like that song said a while ago, there's a new name written in heaven, and that name is mine, and that name is yours. You need to give the Lord a hand clap tonight, because God can save anybody that will choose to come to him. Now, thank God. A lot of people say God can do anything, amen, that will allow him to do. Glory to God. So the Bible says he died for us. Whether we awake or sleep, we should live together with him. See, God had plans for us. And that is that when we get died, and if the Lord's willing, if the Lord don't come back, we're all going to die. Can I hear an amen? And church, let me tell you something. We're going to be with him. Sister Parents talking about wanting to go be with the Lord. Now, I'm ready to go with the Lord. But see, God has chosen us to be here tonight. Paul said, I am betwixt two opinions. So he would rather us be down here and doing a work for him. And then when we get to heaven, we'll have some rewards. I said, when we get to heaven, we'll have some rewards. But thank God, amen, God can save anybody that will come to him. And not only that, you know what, church? I believe we're living in a world today. The Bible says, many are the afflictions of the righteous. Now, church, a lot of God's people are going through a lot of afflictions and a lot of tribulation stuff. Amen. See, people don't come to church anymore. People don't talk about the Lord anymore. You know what, church? When Christians go through the same thing, have the affliction as the same thing as a sinner has, and go through tribulation as a sinner has, this gives us an opportunity to lift up God, to give us an opportunity to glorify God, and to give us an opportunity to be a witness for God. So sometimes God allows us to go through afflictions and go through tribulation and go through sickness and go through these things that we may lift him up and glorify him, because these sinner people don't come to church anymore. So the only way that God can get a hold of people is to let his people suffer and let his people glorify him and lift him up and glorify him and walk in the comfort and the trust of God. So the Bible teaches us only God can comfort those in tribulation that will trust in him going through tribulation. How many knows you got to trust God? I mean, church, let me tell you something. It's easy to trust God when you're on the mountaintop. It's easy to trust God when you got money in the bank. It's easy to trust God when you're feeling real good. It's easy to trust God when things are going your way. But church, when things begin to turn around, how then do you realize really trust God. Now can you say like the three Hebrew boys, now I know my God is able. Like the song we sung a while ago, I know my God can do it. I know my God can, amen, can treat me just the way he did that Daniel and the lions did, or treat me like the three Hebrew boys. God can do it, but sometimes God chooses us to walk through some things that will show the family, show the loved ones, and show our neighbors that we're going to trust God, and that God is a God of all comfort in every tribulation, in all affliction, that God will always be there. So church, let me tell you something. Don't be amazed when you're going through something. Look and ask God, Lord, what are you doing? Are you choosing me? What is this that happened to me? Am I able to do a work for you? See, the Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Now, as we look into 2 Corinthians chapter 1, beginning at verse 3, blessed be God, and even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort. See, God is a God of all comfort. He's there to comfort us in everything that we go through. We just got to trust God. Bible says, trust God in all of his ways. Trust him with all thine heart. If you could trust God in your bad times, in your tribulations, and in your afflictions, then God is using you, and God is giving you the strength, and God is giving you the power, and he's giving you the courage to go through this, that you may lift up his name and glorify him, and let the world know that he is God, and we serve a living God that is able to take care of us and able to conquer us through any kind of tribulation. Oh, glory to God. I'm feeling this tonight. Glory to God. This is what it says. He's the Father of all mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforteth us in all our tribulation. It says all of our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort them which are in trouble, in any trouble. Let me read that again. Who comforteth us in all of our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort them which are in trouble. So God left us as God, his people, the one that he treasures, with the apple of his eye. We're his jewels, but then he's chosen us to go through affliction and chosen us to go through tribulation, that we may be a comfort to them that are going through the same thing. See, people are going through the same thing that we're going through with, but you know what? We've got God to comfort us. We've got God to lift us up. We've got God to give us courage. We've got God to give us hope through Jesus Christ. And therefore, when we go through something, we should look at God and say, God, I thank you that you have found me worthy and strong enough to go through this, that I may lift up your name, that I may glorify you, and show the dying world and the sinners and the unbelievers that there is a God. This is what it says. Who comfort us in all of our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble, by the comfort where we ourselves are comforted of God. So the same God that will comfort us will be able to comfort them. Verse 9 says, For as the suffering of Christ abound in us, so our consolation also abounded by Christ. And whether we be afflicted, it is for your consolation and salvation. So when we're going through this for other sinners and unbelievers things, this is for their salvation. This is for their consolation. This is for their hope, letting them know that there is a God that can give them strength. See, God can do it, church. God can help anybody to go through tribulation and through affliction if we'll just allow ourselves to trust God and not walk by feelings or not walk by sight, but walk in trusting in God. Thank God, like that song says, I know my God can do it. He hears my prayers. He hears your prayers, and God will see us through, and he will answer the prayer. Amen. Woo! Lord, give the Lord a hand clap before we give up. He's there to help us, church. Amen. See, God, he can save the most lost person in the world. And he can comfort the one that in the most tribulation. And not only that, but you know what? God wants to prosper his children. We see so many Christians today that they're not successful and they're not prosperous. They're always down. In fact, the son talks about, well, I'm down on my luck. Let me tell you something. I don't believe in luck. I don't believe in, I'm not superstition. I believe everything happened for a reason. And God has directed our past. Amen. When God directs our past, He's going to bring some good things. But there is times that there is principle about things that God works in our life. See, most Christians get in trouble because they're not allowing the principle of things of God. And God has principles, amen, and therefore we have to walk in those principles or walk in His ways that God can cause us to be blessed and cause us to be prosperous. And you know what, church? He gave us this right here. Amen. God wants His people to prosper and He wants them to be successful. But church, let me tell you something. We can't take and tear things out of this Bible and take things out of this Bible. We've got to read it from Genesis to the book of Revelation, and we can't take nothing from it, and we can't add nothing to it, but take the good old gospel King James Version and believe every word that it says. Like the Bible tells us in Revelation 1 and 3, I believe it says, blessed he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and to keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. See, we are blessed when we take God's word, we listen to God's word, and read God's word, and study God's word, and we will be successful, and we will be prosperous, because God has promised, and God doesn't change. He doesn't promise one person this, and another person that. If we walk upright with God, and walk with God, and walk in His principles, and walk in His word, He will cause us to prosper, and He will cause us to be blessed. Amen. Now hear an amen. Bible tells us in the book of Joshua, He told Joshua. Now God is no respecter of person. What He told Joshua, He's telling us. Can I say that again? What He told Joshua, He's telling us. We're going to the same place as Joshua. The Bible says that God was taking Joshua and Israel to the land of milk and honey. You know, God has taken us to a land of milk and honey. And the same Bible, the same words that God gave Joshua, is the same words that He gave us. And if we walk in His word and walk in the principle of it and look straight and follow it the way God wants us to walk, in this life we'll prosper and we'll be successful and get ready for the next life.
Amen.
The Bible tells us in Joshua chapter 1, verse 7. See, God told Joshua, see, we got to be strong. We live in a world today that is wishy-washy. We got to live in the, we're living in a world today that they're watering down the word so much. Amen. I tell you, I don't like 2% milk. Now I think they went down to 1% milk now, don't they? And I tell you, I just shouldn't drink water, either drink water or drink milk. And they watered they have watered the word of God even more. Now it used to be 2%, now it's 1%. Give me the whole milk, or I don't want no milk at all. Just give me water. Can I hear an amen? And so that's the way God's word is. They got the word watered down so much that it has no power and no effect on nobody, and yet they're on the way to the devil's hell because they don't have enough word, amen, to be strong and in the power of God. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10, amen, tells us, He said, find my brother, be strong in the Lord and the power of His might. That means put on the whole armor of God that you can fight the devil. And church, you can't fight the devil on watered down 1% milk or watered down 1% word. It will not work.
Amen.
Oh, glory to God. Give a Lord a hand clap. God told Joshua, only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from him to the right hand or to the left. So you can't turn to the right or to the left. When God says something, that's what He means. And we can't turn away from it. A lot of people take the scriptures and turn away from it. You've got to walk with the scriptures. And whether it hurts, whether it hits, whether it steps on your toes, you still got to accept the word of God and go on and say, oh me, or ouch, or whatever, and go with God, because in the long run, God is going to bless us, and we're going to be prosperous, and we will say, God has been working on us. Praise God. God knew what He meant to tell Joshua, to tell us. That's what it says there. In verse 8. Or first, back to verse 7. It says that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. Do you know what meditating is? It's like a cow. Have you ever seen a cow chew grass, swallow grass? You know what they do? They chew on that grass a little while, and they belch it back up and chew on it again. And they melt it back up and they chew on it. It sounds like that, but you know what? That makes the purest white milk you ever seen. I don't know how you can eat green grass and come out white milk, but God knows what He's doing. Can I hear an amen? So this is what meditate means. It means to chew over it. See, a lot of times people just read over the Bible. They don't ask themselves questions. They don't ask them, God, what do you mean? And since they miss out on a lot of things, it's because they don't take time to digest it, meditate upon it, and study upon it, that God can bless them and give them an understanding. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
Oh, glory to God. It said that they shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then, thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. That's good enough for me right there, church. So if you want to have success, see, God can prosper us, and God can have us to be successful. God can do this, but if we go with the principles of God, God works on principles. Like our kids. Our kids go on principles. When we tell our kids to do something, we bless them if they do it. But if the kids don't do it, we don't bless them. Well, today we do, but we shouldn't. Amen? So God can cause us to prosper and be successful. Amen? So what a thought God gave me tonight. He wants to share it with you that, you know, God wants us to prosper. He wants us to be successful. God wants to save every sinner. And God wants us to be able to go through tribulation and affliction because God has chosen you. I think when they sing a song sometimes, I counted on Jonah, but he proved untrue. Well, how does that go? I counted on Adam. I counted on Jonah. Anyway, they all was untrue, amen? So God is counting on us that when we go through affliction and when we go through trial, because see, God directs our paths. When God directs our path, the Bible says that God led the children of Israel into the wilderness and they began to murmur and complain because it wasn't the kind of journey they were expecting. Sometimes we go through a journey that we don't expect and we shouldn't complain and we shouldn't murmur, but just give God the glory and say, God, you're leading me through this and I'm going to trust you. I'll give the Lord a hand clap. Glory to God. I just feel like this for another half hour. Number four is God can lead any of those to heaven, those that want to go. Can I say that again? But you know what we have to do? We have to want to stay on the straight path. See, we want to go the wide way. We want to go the broad way. And what it says is, I want to go my way. You don't go your way. You don't go the broad way. You go the straight way, which is God's way. For Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And no man can come unto the Father except by Him. Can I hear an amen? For God can lead to those in heaven who are willing to stay on the right path. The Bible says in Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 16. Now, if we look into Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 16, it says, this saith the Lord, stand in the ways and see and ask for the old paths. Man, we don't want the old paths anymore. It's straight, it's narrow, sometimes it'd be rough, amen? But we want the broad way. It says, ask for the old paths, where is the good way, and walk therein. So God wants us to walk in the good way where we can find rest for our soul. God gives us rest in our soul. But the Bible tells us in the New Testament, in Matthew chapter 7, verse 13 and 14, Jesus said, enter ye into the straight gate. So we gotta get into the straight gate, okay? For wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction. And many, this is what it says, and many there be which go in therein. Look at the world today. Look at the church today. The Bible said that the last days, amen, people will heap to themselves with itching ears, amen, and you have to. You have to baby them. You have to preach what they want to hear. They don't want to hear about you got a straight act. You don't want. They don't want to be reproved and rebuked. Bible told Timothy. He said, "You reprove them and you rebuke them and exhort them." Amen. See that everybody wants to be exhorted, but they don't want to be rebuked or they don't want to be reproved. We're living in a time that there needs to be some reproving and rebuking. And guess what? They need to start with the pastors and the preacher, because they need to get some backbone in them, get that yellow strip out of their back, and start preaching the word of God. Quit worrying about the number. Quit worrying about their tithes. And quit worrying about their congregation. Quit worrying about their reputation. And begin to preach what God tells them, and reprove them, and rebuke them, and then lift them up, and tell them God has a good way to go on giving.
Amen.
The straight way and narrow way, there's two different ways, church. Bible says in verse 14, because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. So I tell you, when Jesus comes back in the rapture, there will be few people go up. Because they all choose the broad way. Bible says Jesus come back after a church that without spot, blemish, or wrinkle. That means we got to be on our toes. That means we got to be watching, praying, and be ready to go up. Can I hear an amen? Amen. To be taken up, you got to be ready to be taken up.
Right.
In closing tonight, the Bible says in Jeremiah chapter 21, verse 8, and unto this people thou shalt say, thus saith the Lord, behold, I set before you the way of life and the way of death. So there's a broad way which represents death, and there's a short way represents life. Church, we've got to choose the right one. God can save us. God can deliver us. God can conquer us. And God can lead us to heaven if we'll stay on the right path. And too many people have got off the right path.
Right.
I never forget one time down in Kentucky. And I tell you, if you've ever been hunting lost in Kentucky, you're in trouble.
Right.
Miles and miles and miles of nothing but woods. And I got turned around. How has ever been turned around? Even driving a car, you got turned around. And boy, everything seems like everything seems the same. You walk around in circles. We've got a lot of God's people walking around in circles. And I begin to pray. I got turned around, I begin to pray. I mean, I was miles up the woods by myself. And I finally, thank God, I talked to a little narrow path. And you talk about somebody being happy, I was happy. Amen. You know why? Because I know that little path was going to take me somewhere. You get on that little path, and you stay on that little path, it's going to take you somewhere.
Right.
And sure enough, it took me about 2 or 3 miles out of my way to my home. But I got home, amen.
Amen.
I'm here to tell you, church, thank God for the little narrow path.
Amen.
God gave us a narrow path that we can get to heaven, that we can get home, and stay on the narrow path, because God can take you to heaven.
Amen.
Would you stand tonight, praise God?